So yeah, it's good that I am at the end of this part because so my presentation is substantially different. I will talk through my practice-led, practice-based research, and I will show a lot of images. Images of people that try to communicate the situation in Greece, the so-called debt crisis. And in the context of this seminar, I think it connects to both geopolitical characteristic, but how also this struggle connects to other struggles around the world, as Darit explained before, and but also as a model for communication for future actions. In this context, I developed a practice-led research that intends to determine similarities in agitational visual languages in support of grassroots movements that emerge in response to economic and social crisis. From the 15M movement in Spain, the square movements around the world, like Occupy, and the continuous anti-austerity movement around the world. The term agitational visual language is used to describe the visuals and graphics that can critically intervene the spaces where the social and political discussion take place. In this framework, I examine the work of groups or individuals who design the organs of information, such as sign, posters, newspapers, or printed and digital media that comprise crucial component of our public sphere. In the outbreak of the so-called debt crisis, and the arrival of the International Monetary Fund in Greece, resulted in the implementation of a shock therapy with hard austerity measures that many describe as an experiment to be applied in other countries, in the process of creating new debt colonies. In the attempt to save the banking system, since 2010, the Greek governments have signed a memoranda with the Troika, the IMF, the European Central Bank, and the EU. The social impact of these policies was unemployed, homelessness, child food insecurity, increased suicide rates, and a new generation of economic migrants. This situation generated a series of responses in which thousands of people took to the streets to protest, occupied workplaces, self-organized, and created community assemblies. Under these circumstances, the agitational visual languages, from handmade banners and posters to digital propaganda, have located at the heart of the movement as a response to this situation. In this context, I will discuss visuals from a number of pivotal events in Greece from 2008 to the present, which, as Douzinas describes, such events have a potential to dialectically shape our history, our collective history. The 2008 youth takeover was a consciousness-shifting period for the new generation in Greece. The protests started on the 6th of December, took over several cities in the country after the police shooting of a 15-year-old student, Alexis Grigoropoulos, in the district of Exarchia in the center of Athens. Many suggest that the riots were a forerunner to the protest events that would follow until the current period of the economic crisis. By discussing a number of visuals utilized in the process in the period, we see that communication tactics that both reject the presenting language but also revive the and reuse particular aspect of it. And I quote here Cornetis from 2010, even though the activist repertoire was pretty much removed from the past, the discourses often echoed or reverberated its exact moments. Similarly, we see the use of popular culture and humor. And an important example of from Athens is the Remember the 6th of December stencil that references the Guy Fawkes mask and the slogan from the Hollywood film V for Vendetta. In a comparable example, the posters that were created by a social center after the Achirizomenos Tekiano Kato Patision in December events utilizes images of a broken window from the riots and the lyrics of a popular protest song of the 60s, which translates, I will break this wall that is made of glass and I will build another new society. In the next years, modern forms of visual resistance will also emphasize on the political potential of humor, visual memes, and the graphic design, similar to the visuals that was encountered onto the street of Athens during the events. In a comparison, Sonning described that similar memes such as the race fist, the recent image of the policeman pepper spraying during Occupy, and the guy folk mask and the Abu Ghraib hood are images that remain in the radical domain. The 2008 riots was also a forerunner of tactics, networks, and visual connection in struggles elsewhere. For instance, the use of technology and the social media played a crucial role for the first time in Greece. In the next years, we will see that similar tactics and tools will become dominant elsewhere. In the context of agitational visual communication and visual languages, numerous were channeled into the digital online networks, such as this collection of graphics onto Flickr by Greek designers in response to the riots. Some of the responses focus on the use of culture jamming and direct provocation on the languages of the opponent by superimposing the visual language of the official tourism campaign for Greece onto a striking image of the riots. Similarly, images of the riots appeared and utilized in poster and graphics elsewhere. For example, the cover of the Canadian magazine Adbuster in March-April 2008 featured the masked protester from Athens. The image can be interpreted as a symbol of a celebration of the new episodes and also a departure from the old. It is important to note that a departure from the old, but also a connection to the party protest aesthetics in the UK in the 80s and 90s. It is important to note that the Adbuster made the first call for Occupy Wall Street in 2011 and using similar images from Greece. The next episode is the 2011, in May 2011, the square of Athens, Syntagma Square, was occupied, where daily assemblies with thousands of participants were organized every day via online media against austerity. Many suggest that the occupation was partly inspired by events of the Arab Spring, and in specific by the occupation of Tahrir Square in Cairo. The occupation is comparable to the protest in Spain, UK, US, UK, and Turkey, and other protests recently that had urban focus and the focus on the public square. There are notable visual connections from the occupations. As a synthesis to the handmade banners and the signs that appear in occupied Syntagma Square and later in New York, London, and other cities. In I Am So Angry I Made a Sign, Michel Tosin discusses the impact of a sign in relation to the audience that was living, visiting, and observing the occupation in Zuccotti Park in New York. Most of all, and I quote, most of all, I was struck by the statuesque quality of many of the people holding up their handmade sign like centaurs, half person, half sign. The writer traces the form of visual coexistence of the protester and the placard, thereby suggesting the significance of the human aspect in the visual communication. In comparison, the human side and the handmade message was effectively captured by designers in other places, such as Sandy Kate in Berlin and Jole Balmanovic in Belgrade. After Syntagma Square occupation, violent eviction in Syntagma Square occupation, and the implementation of another package of austerity measure, in the recent years we watched the focus of the resistance in the neighborhood. People work together in social movements, replacing the state and proposing alternatives from below. An important example is the labor clubs that are self-organized spaces of workers, unemployed, and students that aim to provide mutual support, cultural events, education, but also healthcare. This structure emerged in several cities in Greece as an alternative response to the period of economic crisis following the summer of 2011 and the movement of the squares. Labor clubs do not provide charity, but they focus on a form of practical class solidarity that can be summarized in the Marx words used in one of their posters, from each according to his ability to each according to his need. Since 2011, I co-designed several graphic material on the labor club in Smyrna, Athens. Most of those were posters designed to be fly-posted onto the neighborhoods, but also shared online in order to engage a wider audience into the activities of the labor club. In a recent article called Social Reproduction and Collective Care, the research collective Collective Care Project outlines some of the findings about mutual aid initiatives within contemporary struggles. For example, in Spain, and like the Plataforma Afectados de la Hipoteca and Occupy Sandy, as important examples of community organizing that could do things that the state could not. Both examples have comparable visual communication to use to those of the Greek labor clubs that aim to engage a wider audience with pictograms and infographics that inform the reader in a transparent manner. So this is another example that maybe I will skip for now. And then I will go to the 2015. The first coalition government with an anti-austerity position was elected, which after months of post-election negotiation with a Eurogroup called the referendum. The referendum was whether to accept the new series of measures proposed by the Troika and has been described by the media as a big challenge for the Eurozone's future. However, many people saw this as an opportunity to stand with dignity against austerity. The week before the referendum, the two campaigns started, the No and the Yes, both with appropriate to their target audience visual style and identity. Nevertheless, the most pertinent agitational visual voice emerged again from below. Only the No campaign had such a wave of anonymous, unofficial messages, graffiti and posters. This was also empowered by a plethora of messages from international solidarity from cities across Europe and the world through online media networks. In the UK, activists projected messages on the German embassy in London for debt cancellation in Greece in solidarity with the struggles against austerity, in a practice that connects to techniques that we also observed in 2011 and 12, used by the Occupy movement. Political messages that can be channeled from the virtual to the physical space reflect the dual character of this contemporary mobilization that is linked to a Spanish 15M slogan, digital indignation, analog resistance. This timeline discussed landmark events of how people in this southern end of the Balkans peninsula resisted and made aspects of an unprecedented crisis more visible. Between victories and defeats, these events can discuss where the alternative might emerge. The analysis of this protest repertoire can reveal networks of solidarity, evidence of visual self-consciousness, as well as model for future creative action in Greece, Europe, and the world. And most importantly, to make visible the transnational struggle of thousands of people crossing the borders of the continent. And I would like to close with this poster from Sunday in Greece that is portrayed a striking image of a Syrian woman crossing the borders of Turkey to Greece, holding her two kids, against the image of hate of the Golden Dawn politicians.